seas. Your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will never lift my hands, for I will always sing when your love came down. Your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hand, for I will always sing when your love came down. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love.
Here, this is Holly Naz. If you're online, thank you for joining us. Let's open with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, just thank you for your great love and your blessings over our lives, Lord. Thank you that your favor has no end, Lord, but it lasts for our entire lifetime. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Is my desire.
Let's sing it to our Lord.
Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake. Lord, have your way with me. Lord, have your way with me.
Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name.
All right, let's sing it out.
Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Blessed
be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. You give and take away. Heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name.
You give and take away.
You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name.
Blessed be the
name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Blessed
be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Amen. You may be seated.
What? That was fun. I thought that was fun.
I thought it was fun.
The rest of you have fun?
Yay.
Absolutely, right? Good stuff. Welcome to church, everybody. Okay, let's try that again. Welcome to church, everybody. Oh, perfect, perfect. I mean, where else would you rather be on a beautiful, sunny Sunday morning? Somewhere, just not here, right? But it's still a beautiful morning. Every day that we get up, every day that we take breath, is a day to praise the Lord and say, thank you, Lord, for everything, right? Literally everything. So, as we devote to 242, one of the things that we do is we devote ourselves to the Apostles' teaching, which is simply reading the Bible 75 minutes a day. No, 7 minutes a day, right? Who has 7 minutes a day available? Yeah, I can find 7 minutes a day. And the thing is even if I don't sit down and open it up, you know there are things on your telephone, your little mobile device here, that will read to you? So if you read it or you listen to it, is it the same thing? Absolutely, right? So you can do either or. And I encourage you to do either or. And one of the interesting things about the Bible is it's super clear. Everything is like, can't miss it, right? No. So I have this cast iron pan here. Who cooks with cast iron? Who knows how to take care of a cast iron pan? Yeah. So you take it after you're done with it and you wash it in soap and water? No. You take it in the stream, you wash it in sand, right? Or you know, so it's interesting because as I was reading about, you know, how to wash a cast iron pan, the right way to take care of it, somebody actually said you never use a metal utensil on a cast iron pan. I use a metal utensil all the time. I mean, it's all I ever use, right? And they say, well, don't scrub it too hard. What does that mean? You know, but so, and then when you're done with it, after you clean it up and you know, how do you dry it? You put it on a fire and then you oil it. You know, some people say you're not supposed to do that. I know, isn't that crazy? So a mundane thing like taking care of a cast iron pan we can't agree upon. You really think we're agree upon scripture? Oh, come on, people. Let's get real, right? And that's just one example. Really, there is more than one way to skin a cat, is there not? Absolutely. So when we look at the word, all things, what's that? Maybe. But as we look at the word, we read the word in 7 minutes a day, let God speak to you. Let the Holy Spirit speak to you. Don't go with a preconceived notion, right? Open it up, read it. There's only one thing in the word that I say is off limits as far as arguing about and disagreeing about. Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Right? All the rest of that stuff, we're going to have different ways, different views of looking at it, and that's okay. But you are not a Christian. You can't be a Christian unless you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. That's the definition of being a Christian, is it not? The only way to salvation is through him. But we could debate the rest, and we do debate the rest, and that's okay. Also, as we devote to 242, we devote to the fellowship. We hang out together. We should be hanging out together outside these walls. And I'm encouraged because I see people in our church doing that. They like to spend time together, eating together, getting to know one another besides just in the church. That's what we're supposed to do, right? Life is messy. God put us together to do life together, not to listen to me together. That's not what he put us here for, but to actually spend time together, get to know one another, to pray for one another, to encourage one another, to uplift one another, to carry each other's burdens, help with each other's struggles. That's devoting to the fellowship. And we devote to prayer. We need to pray for one another. Specifically for one another. I like to pray Philippians 1, 9 through 11. I pray that your love will overflow more and more, that you will keep growing in knowledge and understanding. For I want you to understand what really matters, so that you may live pure and blameless lives until the day of Christ's return. May you always be filled with the fruit of your salvation, the righteous character produced in your life by Christ Jesus. For this will bring much glory and praise to God. We pray for one another as we devote to 242. Who needs prayer today? Everybody, but I want to pray for one specific person. I want to pick on one person today. Who am I picking on? Cheryl? Okay, I'm picking on Cheryl. Fantastic. Like nobody's like, no, don't pray for me. No, I don't want, no, please don't. It's funny because we should all be jumping up saying, no, me. Oh, Lord, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for your love, for your grace, and your mercy. And Lord, we thank you that you love us so much. It blows our minds. And Father, I want to lift Cheryl up to you, Lord. I want to place her before you, Lord. And I, Lord, number one, I want her love to overflow more and more. And number two, Holy Spirit, I want you to just wash over her and give her the peace of mind that just surpasses all understanding. Lord, I want her to just have joy indescribable. Lord, when she just wakes up in the morning, let all the worries, all the cares, all the frustrations, let her just put them all on you. Let her just say, you know what, today, Lord, I'm going to choose love. And everything I do, I'm going to choose love. And then, Holy Spirit, fill her up to overflowing. Give her a triple portion of you today, tomorrow, throughout the week, where she's just, every step she takes, she just feels your presence, that she's surrounded by your love. And then fill her up so much that it overflows out of her and into everybody she comes in contact with. Lord, we know you can do infinitely more than we ask or think, and I'm asking you to just blow her mind this week with how much she is loved by you and by us. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen. Do I have a usher?
So, I've been going to church a long, long, long time. Not that long.
But yeah, I have an offering plate right here.
This would be the, this is the very first time that I've ever done an offering.
There you go, with a special offering plate.
Is that what you want?
Unless you want to go get the one from Sandy. Oh, Lord, we thank you again for your love, for your grace, and your mercy. And as we take just a few moments to give back to you, Holy Spirit, I ask that you take these gifts, you take these offerings, and again, you multiply them and do so much more than we can possibly think or imagine. In your name we pray, amen. I give online, and I give once a month. Usually it's the second Sunday of the month is when I go through, because I get paid, and I go through and set up the budget and set up everything, and I got this line item in my budget. One of the very first line items in my budget is the tithe, because the first of my fruits go where? Go to God, right? And I look at it when it gets to a certain amount, and I'm like, whoa, wait a minute, I need to tithe, and I tithe. Do it online. Works for me. Right? It's just the same giving it online as it is giving in here. Or if you even mail in a check, right? There's some people that have automatic tithing set up. So they don't even think about it anymore. Right? It just comes out once a month or twice a month, or however it is. And it when we give back to him, I give it to him. I'm not giving it to Holly Naz, I'm giving it to God. Right? And then it's his after that point. I don't look at it. I don't think about it. I mean, I have to because I'm the pastor and it's part of my job. But that's a different story, right? I'm not then looking at my money anymore. This is God's money, right? However the leadership team decides to spend it, it's God's money, right? And we need it to keep the lights on and keep the heat on. And it wouldn't be nice to walk in here on a December morning and have it be 50 degrees in here, would it? No, so it's simple things like that that I'm asking God to multiply, because I don't want to just keep the lights on. Right? I want to have so much more than people call me up and say, hey, can you help me out? What I'm trying to do is get people to, I don't just want to give money away anymore. You want me to help you out? Come talk to me. Come talk to me first. Let me see you face to face. Oh, I don't want to do that. All right. Sorry, I'm not going to help you out then. It's like a pre-whack. If you really need money to help, you don't want to come talk to me for 10 minutes and see me face to face? I'm not going to give you money and a call over the phone. Maybe that makes me a bad person. You know? So, do you strive to follow all that Jesus said to do? We all try, maybe. Maybe. I don't think we do all try, actually, to strive to do all that Jesus said to do, right? Because not everyone, no one, not one Christian does everything that Jesus told us to do. Period. End of discussion. Jesus said some really wild and crazy, outrageous things for us to do. He did he not? I mean, there's one thing that I can absolutely prove with empirical data that Jesus said that I've never met one Christian in their right mind that has ever done this. Matthew 5:29-30. You don't have to open it up. Just let me read it. So if your eye, even your good eye, causes you to lust, gorge it out and throw it away. It's better to lose one part of your body than your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your hand, even your stronger hand, causes you to sin, cut it off, throw it away. For it's better to lose one part of your body and for your whole body to be thrown in hell. Obviously, I have both my eyes, so I've never looked at a woman and lusted after her, right? Yeah, right? that's not even feasible. It isn't. Have you ever met a Christian that follows this? I haven't, right? So we look at this particular scripture right here. Literally, it's at Matthew 5:29-30, right? So I'm looking at that, and I'm saying, okay, Jesus is speaking figuratively. Right? He didn't really mean it for us to gouge his eye, for us to gouge our eyes out. Never. That'd be crazy. We wouldn't even think about it. However, verse 29 puts me in a little bit of a quandary. Does anyone know what verse 28 is? Verse 28, but I say, anyone who even looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in her heart. I've never met a single Christian or talked to a single Christian that does not take this scripture literal. So I take verse 28 literal. If I look at a woman and I lust after her, I've committed adultery. Yet verse 29 I take figuratively. Who makes that decision? Pretty much yourself, right? You could listen to some other person, that some other person could say, you know, I'm going to tell you, Sharon, what's literal, and I'm going to tell you what's figurative. But ultimately, we make that decision, and what do we make it based on? Good luck, right? However you choose. And that's a quandary. It really is, because every Christian I've ever talked to has to make this decision. It's simply not possible to do everything that Christ has told us to do. Does it mean we shouldn't strive to do it? We should strive to do a lot of the things Christ said to do, because a lot of things Christ said to do are really beneficial for us. They really are. Let's flip to Luke 6. And in Luke 6, Jesus is going to lay out some things that are difficult, outright crazy. Like when we read them, could you imagine standing in front of him as we're going to read these verses? He's going to say them. You're going to look at Jesus. You're going to go, dude, you're out of your mind. No way will I do that. That's just impossible. That just can't be done. However, it can be done. So Luke 6. In Luke 6, Jesus is talking to the crowd. And this is what he says in verse 27. But to you who are willing to listen, I say, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who hurt you. If someone slaps you on one cheek, offer the other also. If someone demands your coat, offer your shirt also. Give to anyone who asks. And when things are taken away from you, don't try to get them back. Do to others as you would like them to do to you. If you love only those who love you, why should you get credit for that? Even sinners love who love them. And if you do good only to those who do good to you, why should you get credit? Even sinners do that much. And if you lend money to those who can only repay you, why should you get credit? Even sinners will lend to other sinners for a full return. Love your enemies. Do good to them. Lend to them without expecting to be repaid. Then your reward in heaven will be very great, and you will be truly acting as children of the Most High, for he is kind to those who are unthankful and wicked. You must be compassionate, just as your Father is compassionate. And he goes on, do not judge others, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn others, or it will all come back against you. Forgive others, and you will be forgiven. Give, and you will receive. Your gift will return to you full, pressed down, shaken together to make room for more, running over and pouring into your lap. The amount you give will be determined by the amount you get back. All right. Who at this point is walking away from Jesus? Love your enemies. Love your enemies. Jesus, you're pretty funny. You're kind of out of your mind, right? Love your enemies. So an enemy is someone who actively opposes or hates you or tries to harm you or stop you from doing something. Now, I'm going to go on a limb here. When Jesus says love your enemies, he's not talking just loving your literal enemies, but he's talking about loving the enemies that you believe are your enemies that may not really be your enemy. You have any of those? People you think are opposing you for some reason? May or may not be? Yeah. And Jesus says what? Love them. Get even with them. Yeah, in a loving way, right? No, that's not what he says in any way, shape, or form. That's one of those things we like to add in there, right? Love your enemy. Man, no way, Jesus, I'm not loving my enemy. You've got to be crazy. But that's what he says. If you're willing to listen, I say love your enemies. Love them. Do good to those who hate you. Who wants to do good to people who hate you? That's a tough one, is it not? Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. What's your reaction when someone curses you? Curse them back, right? What's Jesus say to do here? Bless them. Not just love them, but also bless them. That person's cursing you, Deb. You should bless them instead. Okay, Jesus, sure. Yeah. Pray for those who hurt you. Lord, this person hurt me. Lord, I want you to hurt them back. That's not the prayer he wants, is it? No, especially when he's going down, love your enemies. You know, do good to those that don't do good to you. Pray. What should we pray for the people that hurt us? Lord, bless them. Lord, bestow your love on them like you've never had before. What does that do to you when you take that stance? It's better off for you, right? Instead of you trying to get back at them. If someone slaps you on one cheek, offer the other also. How does that one work for you, Will? Go ahead, punch me. Oh, you know what? That was a good one. Try better this time. Come on, I know you can hit me harder. Come on. Not necessarily the attitude, but it's like you don't fight them back, right? They hit you, you're like, okay, yeah, I'm going to hit me again, go for it. That's some tough stuff. That is really some tough stuff. If someone demands your coat, offer your shirt also. You know, it's interesting. I was growing up, we had these little Christian tracts we would read. And this one, the guy is being robbed. They're beating him up. They're robbing him. They take his wallet, and they're flipping through his wallet, and they're getting ready to run. He says, hold on a minute. They're like, they turn around. What do you want, old man? He goes, I have money in my pocket, too. Think about that. Yeah, but even if it doesn't stop them, that's the kind of attitude we should have towards them. You want my, you here, you want it? Take it all then. You know, it's okay. It's just stuff. It's not mine. That's blessing those that curse you. That's loving your enemies. That's doing good to those that hurt you. That is radical thinking and radical actions. Outrageous, crazy stuff. You have that kind of attitude towards people? Can you even possibly think that way? Towards them? You can. It's tough to do. But that's what he wants us to do. He wants us to be totally different than what the world expects us to be. You know what? I absolutely dare you to do these words. I absolutely dare you to listen to these words of Jesus, not just listen to them, but put them into practice. Love your enemies. Love them. Do good to them. And let me see that coming out of you and from you. Let those around you and everybody you come in contact with see that you're loving your enemy, not hating them. Oh, wait a minute, Pastor. It's one thing for me to love them, but you really want me to show it? Come on. No, I don't think so. I think Jesus wants us to be that way. In verse 37, he says what? Do not judge others, and you will not be judged. Who likes to judge others? We do it, though, don't we? Yeah. How do you not judge others? I mean, I'm always judging other people. I can't not do that. I had to actively think and put into practice ways to not judge others, to now start to understand, okay, this person is doing something I can't stand, or doing something I think is really stupid, or, you know, all right, Lord, why are they doing that? Help me to understand where they're coming from. Help me to understand why they would do things differently than me. Because ultimately, I'm judging them because they're doing something differently than me. To try and have compassion on people, to see them in a different light, it takes a lot of effort to do so. I think some people don't like talking to me very much when they come and complain about somebody. I don't often do it, but I try to do it as much as possible when Catherine's complaining to me about somebody, to say, yeah, but did you ever think that maybe they're thinking about this or thinking about this? And they're like, I don't want you to do that. Don't tell me what they're thinking. They're wrong. They're my enemy. I need to hurt them back. No. Don't judge them. Or better yet, I can't believe that person did that. Oh, okay, but you do this. Wait a minute. No, I don't. Ever get caught with that one? Yeah. It's really easy for us to think we're right in every situation. That's something we do as a race. Doesn't matter how arrogant or ignorant you are, you always think you're right. That's human nature. Not right, wrong, or indifferent. That's just what we do. Who can easily admit they're wrong? It's never easy, right? Because we always want to think we're right. And that's okay, because that's our mindset. That's what God gave us, that ability. I mean, literally, folks, when we're looking at Scripture and thinking about Scripture and having different opinions on Scripture, I have to think my opinion is right for my convictions. Right? I have to think the things that I think are right, because that's how I act upon them. It's totally different to have a mindset, I'm not right, I'm just different. Peggy thinks differently than I do. Peggy's wrong, I'm not. Not the case. Yeah, I want a bat, right? That's not the case. It's not. It's just different. And a lot of our judgments come from the fact that I have this mindset, you have this mindset, and we can't just think that we are different from one another. Don't condemn others. Don't condemn others, or it will come back against you. Again, it's real easy for me to condemn people. And at work, I mean, seriously, I've got people at work that make me want to scream. Why don't you do what you're supposed to do? Why don't you do your job? I'm doing your job better than you're doing your job. Ever that attitude? Yeah. Flip that one. Don't condemn them. Try to understand them. That's tough. It is tough. One of the most difficult things, forgive others. Forgive others. Okay, sure. You're out of your mind. Lord, I have this grudge. I want to hold on to this grudge. I want to carry this grudge, and I want to nurture this grudge, and I want to sing to it. Rock goodbye, baby. So cute. What's that? So I can feel superior. And I'm holding on to this grudge, and this grudge is creating bitterness within me. And this gigantic grudge, it's growing, it's becoming even bigger and bigger, and it's eating away at me. Catherine could care less about the grudge I have against her. Right? You could care less about the grudge I have against you. Yeah. No, I don't have any grudge. I'm just saying, I'm using you because you're right in front of me, right? But maybe you do care a little bit. about a grudge, but most of the time, yeah, I'm going to nurture the grudge. I'm going to grow the grudge. I'm going to keep becoming more and more bitter. Is it going to affect the way Catherine lives? No. And not unless it physically maybe affects her, but it does, right? And God says, forgive others. Take this grudge and forgive them. Does he say forgive and forget and never bring it up again? No. That's never mentioned in Scripture. He forgets our sins, but we don't forget the wrongs against us. But we forgive the wrongs against us. That is one of the most powerful things that we can do as believers, is to forgive others. There's so many things that keep us from growing into the people that God has created us to be. These things that we just read about, like love your enemies, do good to those that harm you. You realize that when we don't love our enemies, that keeps us from being all that God wants us to be. That keeps us stuck. So, when I started the sermon, I talked about literal things and figurative things. Is Jesus literally talking about loving our enemies? And why would I decide that he is literally telling me to love my enemies versus figuratively telling me to love my enemies? What is Scripture summed up in one word? Love. But forgiveness comes out of love, right? Scripture summed up in one word is love. Without love, the rest of Scripture means nothing. So anytime that Scripture is talking about loving, perk up. Think about it. Because love is simply the most important thing we can do, period. End of discussions. When Scripture talks about love, pay attention to it. We can take everything else in Scripture figuratively, but when it talks about love, it's literal, right? Scripture is always going to point to love. The figurative stuff that we read in Scripture is going to point to what? Love. Yeah, exactly. Right? Love, love, and love. And I simply dare you to love like Christ has asked us to love in these verses. When we do so, we become like him. And why would Jesus tell us to love our enemies? Why would he tell us this? Enemies, what's that? So we have peace, right? I mean, think about what an enemy does, whether it's truly a coming against me enemy or a perceived enemy. These enemies create a whole range of negative emotions. We typically are angry against people who hurt us, are we not? Yeah. Bitterness. We harbor anger. We harbor that anger. It leads to bitterness and resentment. Anxiety. Who's anxious when having to deal with your enemies? Yeah, we are, right? We become comfortable with our enemies We become anxious. We become unhappy. When you have enemies out there, people opposing you, and they're coming against you and you have to deal with them, does that usually make you happy? No. All these negative emotions, right? And enemies also distract us. Focusing on our enemies can distract us from working on who? Ourselves. I'm so worried about Will and how he's wronged me. I'm not even thinking about myself. Not only that, I'm not thinking about myself, but I'm not doing what God has called me to do. Because I'm worried about my enemy and treating them as my enemy instead of loving them as Christ has told us to love. What happens when we actually love our enemies, when we actually do the words that Jesus says to do here? The negative emotions fade away. Your anger subsides. The bitterness goes away. Our anxiety is turned into peace. Our unhappiness becomes joy. And we're no longer distracted from doing God's work and becoming the people that God has created us to be. I dare you to read this scripture multiple times this week. Let the words of Jesus change the very way you think and act towards your enemies, towards those who oppose you. I dare you to do that. Because this kind of love is radical. It is totally, completely, utterly outrageous. Most people, most Christians, simply can't live like this. They can't do it. We don't have it within ourselves to follow what Jesus has asked us to do here. I cannot love my enemy on my own. It's not within me to do it on my own. And you know what the most exciting thing about that is? God doesn't expect us to. These crazy, outrageous, wild things that he asks us to do. You know what else he wants to do? Come on, Deb, let me help you do them. When you ask me to help you do them, awesome. Sweet, let's do this. And he's our biggest cheerleader. He's with us. He's carrying us through it. Yeah, you want to love your enemies? Great. Let's do this. If I go out there, I'm going to do it all by myself. He's like, no, wait. No. You're supposed to do this with me. Right? Absolutely. And we should strive to love our enemies. We should strive to do good to those who hate us. We should strive to bless those who curse us. We should strive to pray for those who hurt us. We should strive not to judge others. We should strive not to condemn others. We should strive to forgive everyone. And we should strive to give and give and give. Let's strive to do all that Jesus has asked us to do. I talk about it once or twice, about the fruits of the Spirit. The fruits that who produces in our lives? God, the Holy Spirit produces these fruits. I don't produce them. And I always talk about the first three. Why? Because the first three are consistent and the same in every single translation, regardless of which one you read. Love, joy, and peace. Love overflowing, joy indescribable, peace beyond measure. Okay? Love overflowing, joy indescribable, and peace beyond measure. And if we don't do the things that Jesus asked us to do here, we inhibit the growth of the fruits of the Spirit. The Spirit's not going to force his fruits on us. We're not loving our enemies. We're not doing good to those that hate us. We're not blessing those that curse us. The fruits of the Spirit aren't going to grow anywhere near as fast as they could grow if you do these things. Am I saying you cannot experience the fruits of the Spirit if you don't listen to these words? You can experience love overflowing, joy indescribable, peace beyond measure. You can not love your enemies. You can. You can experience joy indescribable and not love your enemies, do good to those who hurt you and pray for those that wrong you. You can experience joy. You can experience peace. The fruits will grow if you don't do the things that Jesus asked you to do. But you know what happens when you do the things that Jesus asked you to do? The growth is exponential. Like wild growth. When you're simply striving to do what he asked you to do. And the best part about it is, he doesn't want us to strive alone. He wants us to strive not just with him. Look around you, folks. The people in this building, we always strive together, do we not? Do we struggle together? Yes. If you have an issue where you don't love your enemy, and you come up to anybody in this building, say, I have this person, I can't stand them, I do not want to love them, I want to hate them, I want to be bitter towards them, they just tick me off so bad, I can't, they're just consuming me. I dare you, again, to go up to anybody in this building and tell them that. And then to follow it up with, please help me. And what are they going to do? They're going to help. Exactly, right? That's what the church is supposed to be as well. Church is not supposed to be, oh, Mark, you don't like somebody? Dude, there's the door. Get out of here. That's not the church. That's not this church for sure, right? Yeah. Now it's going to be like, great, awesome. Let's walk together. Let's pray together. Let's encourage one another. Right? That's what we're all here for. As we strive to do the words that God said to do, we do it together. And we do it with Him. We become the people He created us to be, which are radical, outrageous, outstanding people that love unconditionally. That's hard to do, but we can do it together. Father, I thank you once again for your love, for your grace, and your mercy. Holy Spirit, help us to remember the words of Jesus here in Luke. Help us to love our enemies. Help us to do good to those that don't do good to us. Help us to pray for those that hurt us. These are some tough sayings, Lord. But you said to do them, and I believe we can do them. And I believe we need you and others to do so. Holy Spirit, grow us together as a church. Not just to be the individuals that you want us to be, but to be the church that you want us to be, to just love, like crazy love, that can only come from you. When people see us, let them see you because of the way we not just think, but the way we act. Lord, help us to love as you loved. Help us to see people as you see them in every single interaction, every single day of our lives. Lord, once again, we thank you that you do give us love overflowing, joy indescribable, and peace beyond measure. In your wonderful name we pray, amen. Those online, have a fantastic week.